All right. So platelets are their own little, they're not part of the clotting cascade. They are called platelets because they look like little plates. An unactivated platelet looks like little plates. And so you can see the unactivated platelets in the left side of that little picture there. And then damaged blood vessels send out a signal to these platelets. And when platelets get activated, they turn into these little octopus-like little guys with tentacles that they become sticky and they adhere to things. So platelets are our first line of clotting defense until our clotting cascade gets there to finish the job. So platelets, and so here I'm going to show you the fun clotting cascade. I don't know, did you guys do this? Did you take anatomy and physiology as a prereq for this class or no? I can't remember. Okay, so this you probably got in anatomy, physiology. Yeah, and everybody's like, oh God, PTSD, A&P. Okay, good. I'm not going to go into detail on the clotting cascade. But what I'm going to show you is that there are two paths for clotting. So the tissue is damaged. The first line of defense is the platelets. So the platelets activate and respond, and they aggravate and create a little platelet plug. That happens almost instantaneously. And then the clotting cascades kind of come along behind and put a big mesh over this plug and make a long-standing clot. So the intrinsic and extrinsic clotting cascades have all a bunch of clotting factors, but guess what? Don't care. Not going to ask you to memorize clotting factors. Both cascades and all their different factors end up in converting prothrombin to thrombin. Thrombin then makes this fibrin and fibrin clot. And that is a nice mesh of proteins that adheres over these little platelets and creates our scabbing clot. Okay? So what I'm going to tell you, though, that is important in these cascade diagram here is that there are two different kinds of meds. So when you are an anticoagulant, you are not on an antiplatelet. And when you are an antiplatelet, you are not on an anticoagulant. Okay? So if you are on a medication to prevent clotting, you would technically have to be on both an antiplatelet and an anticoagulant to fully not create a clot. So do we see how there's two different pathways here? We have the first line of defense, platelets. Then we have a second line of defense, which is your clotting cascade. So antiplatelets work on preventing platelets from activating. So platelets, it doesn't stop your platelets. It doesn't affect your actual platelets in an inactive form. It stops them from turning into those little tentacly sticky guys, and you don't create a platelet plug. But you will still be able to create your fibrin clot unless you run on an anticoagulant. So heparin and Lovenox, they do nothing to break a clot down. They only prevent a fibrin mesh from forming. So that's one of the big things that I hear from nursing is like, oh, we're going to give heparin to break the clot. They don't break clots at all. Neither one of them, antiplatelets or anticoagulants, do not break down clots that have already formed. They only prevent a clot from getting larger. So if you don't throw mesh down on top of it, then the platelets will eventually kind of stop forming, but hopefully something has built up there. And I will tell you that the dosage of anticoagulant is the determinant. So it's not like if you give heparin, you have stopped all fibrin mesh from forming. If you give Lovenox, you stop all fibrin mesh from forming. You just slow it down. It does form, it just takes longer and it prevents things from sticking to it. It doesn't make it as active. Does that make sense? So anticoagulants, one, don't break down any clots. They prevent further clots from forming on top of an already existing clot. They make things less sticky and they make things, they make less thrombin so the mesh isn't as big to catch things as it goes by. So when you already have a clot you're giving an anticoagulant to prevent further clots, and you are giving an anticoagulant to prevent that existing clot that has formed from attracting more things to it and making the clot bigger. Okay, so I wanted to put that there as a place where we could talk about these medications and how they work. So I don't want you thinking, oh, my patient's on aspirin, they won't clot. They will, they just won't form a platelet plug. But there is nothing blocking their actual clotting cascade. So you have to be on a mixture of both to fully slow down clotting. And one versus the other, they do different things. So I'm going to put that there, and we'll talk a little more about. And this is just a picture in case you wanted to see it, where all the factors live. If we are missing a factor or haven't produced these factors, then of course we're not going to work these cascades. So if we have liver damage later on when we talk about liver damage, if you're not making these factor 8, 7, 6, 5, if you're not making those factors, then you won't even create any thrombin. And so you won't make these thrombin meshes and make these fibrin clots. But the nice thing that, if you didn't know, a fun to know fact, that's why PTINR and PTT, they measure two different sides of these clotting cascades. And the only thing you need to know about is that there is an intrinsic and an extrinsic pathway. The intrinsic pathway takes a little bit longer. The extrinsic pathway is pretty quick. But the extrinsic pathway is measured by the PTT, and the intrinsic pathway is measured by the PTINR. So you can see that if we are measuring what heparin's doing, they look at, they're going to be looking at the PTT. If you're measuring what warfarin is doing, it works in the intrinsic pathway, and you're measuring the PTINR. So I'm not going to need you to memorize which ones measure which ones, but when the book says to, you know, measure the PTT, but it doesn't say anything about the PTINR, that's why. It's because your drug works somewhere in one of these pathways. Okay? A little bit more detail, but some people like a little why. So there's a little why behind that. I am going to talk a little bit about clotting, actually what breaks down clots, and the only thing that breaks down clots is TPA. And you're like, wow, that's a med. Well, we also, tissue plasminogen activator is our own natural substance that breaks down clots. And so if you really truly want to break a clot that has formed, you need to give TPA. Anticoagulants inhibit formation of a clot, but they do not break down clots. So the only thing that breaks down clots is TPA, and what we're going to do when we give anticoagulants is we prevent a further clot from forming and a bigger clot from forming, and then our own natural TPA goes in to break up the clot. So when you're giving, your patient comes in with a DVT, and you're giving an anticoagulant, you're not giving heparin to break up the clot. You're giving it to slow down clot formation until our own natural TPA can break it up. Giving TPA is a big deal because not only will it break down the clot that you don't want, it'll break down every clot all over your body and cause massive, massive bleeding. We are constantly, this body is an amazing place. It's constantly under repair. It's like a giant metropolis in there. It's constantly breaking down. It's constantly being repaired. There's small little micro repairs going on all over the place. There's small little micro clots going on all over the place. If you send TPA in at the large doses that we send TPA in to break down clots, it will break down every clot in your body, not just the big one that you want. Any little tiny micro vessels that are damaged or any general wear and tear on the body that's being damaged and being cleaned up will get broken down. So we don't generally give TPA except in emergency clot breakdown needs. And the two emergency clots that we need to break down, probably three, would be stroke, PE, and MI. Usually the standard of care, though, is for those to give heparin or a high dose of heparin and let the clot prevent further formation and let our own natural TPA break it down. But if it's a matter of life and death, they will give TPA. And what TPA does, it will break down the clot that's causing the problem, but it'll break down every clot in your body too. So a lot of concerns with giving TPA. It's better to let our own natural TPA that's better regulated take care of the problem, and we just slow down the clotting process. So any questions on that? Those are pretty heavy concepts, and they're not really addressed anywhere. I wanted to put them here. It doesn't have anything to do with thrombocytopenia, but too bad it can't be directly into the clot. Well, I will tell you that we do actually try to direct anticoagulants and things to the actual clot. We have, is this the drug you have to give within 30 minutes of stroke? Yes. If you are going to give TPA, you have to do it. I believe it has to be within, I don't think it's quite 30 minutes. I think you do it within 30 minutes of arrival, but I think it's within 3 hours of last seen normal. I think they ask the last time that they're seeing normal. And there's a lot of factors to giving TPA. They have to know, have you had any past surgeries within the past 3 months? Because remember, if you've just had a surgery in the past 3 months, there's some clotting going on there and some repair crews. We give TPA, all your surgical sites are going to start bleeding. So that's actually a rule out for TPA. There are a lot of, if you work in the ED, you've probably seen TPA given, and there's a lot of contraindications to giving it, and they run through a whole worksheet of history before they'll give TPA, because you can cause a lot of bleeding with TPA because it's going to directly break down everything. So a postoperative PE is out. Yeah, no TPA on a postoperative PE. Definitely not. Because not only will you break up the PE, but you will basically cause that whole surgical site to start bleeding out. So anyway, I just kind of wanted to put that out there, that antiplatelets are one thing, anticoagulants are another thing, and TPA is the only thing that physically breaks up clots. And it is a pretty high-risk drug. And yes, they do, to answer your question, Margaret, or I think it was Lori, it can be driven directly into the clot. They have developed, we will do that sometimes with people with PEs. They will take them down to interventional radiology and put in a catheter directly to the clot. But you can imagine, this is a central line catheter going straight into your lung. And then they will give small, itty-bitty micro doses of TPA via a pump continuously for about, 8 to 12 hours right at the clot. And then they go back to IR and see if the clot has dissolved. They do that, but you won't be seeing that in clinical. They do have a lot of different things. They actually use vibration therapy to break up clots as well. They have an ECOS catheter that if you get to go to the ICU next semester, hopefully the hospitals won't be closed next semester to you guys. They have a catheter that you can put a catheter directly on top of a clot, like in the leg for a DVT, and send out sonic vibrations to break up the clot. So they are developing a lot of things to try and get at PEs and DVTs, and it's just fascinating because TPA is such a whole body event. So yeah, it's very similar to stones that they have developed that technology that you can put a catheter right on top of the clot and send out vibrations right there to it. We've done TPA straight to clots. We can do heparin delivered right to that area. There's a lot of different things that you can do to get at a clot, but just in general, we're not going to give TPA unless it's a life-threatening condition because of all the side effects that it has. But one of the things you might see in those clotting labs, remember, was the fibrin split products and the fibrin degradation products. Those are products that are released as a clot is being broken down. And so when you're looking at labs and they're doing fibrin split products, then you know, if those are really, really high and the fibrin degradation products are very, very high, we know that the body has a lot of clot that it's trying to dissolve. And we will look at those labs in a couple of different conditions. And those conditions really are disseminated intravascular coagulation, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But some people with some hospital experience might have heard of DIC. We talk about DIC very, very briefly.
But that's the only time we really look at those degradation products and split products and things like that. I think I did put that in the coagulation labs are too far back at the beginning. But in the coagulation labs, I think they are listed there, but they're not a memorizable thing. I would like you to know PT, PTT, and INR. And TPA, that's how we measure the effectiveness of TPAs. We look at those split products and degradation products to see if we are breaking down clots. Just kind of the more you know, the better you are as a nurse. But let's talk about the actual thrombocytopenia. And thrombocytopenia, or thrombocytes are platelets. So just like erythrocytes are red blood cells, thrombocytes are platelets. And this is a reduction of platelets below 150. I think no matter what our book said, 150 was the low point on both books. Reduction of platelets below 150. So that 150 number is going to be kind of big. Anything lower than that, you don't have a lot of circulating platelets. And when you don't have a lot of circulating platelets, you get a lot of microbleeding because platelets are our first line of defense. So things break down all the time. Most of our blood vessels are only like 2 cells thick. Things break down all the time. Something scratches up the surface. The platelets will go there, plug it until the repair team can get there. So if you don't have your first time plug, you're going to have tons of little spots of random spontaneous bleeding, which are kind of petechiae. These purpura is something where you have numerous petechiae coming together, and then ecchymoses are large bruises. They're kind of subjective words. So petechiae, you can see, are kind of pinpoint, and then purpura are multiple pinpoints coming together, and then probably on that foot picture up there, if you could see it really well, an ecchymosis is what we would cause. Maybe that thing towards the back of the foot would be starting to be called an ecchymosis. So we got petechiae are pinpoint, purpura are kind of larger circles, and then ecchymoses are bruises or much larger bleeding. But they're all basically signs of bleeding. And we have three thrombocytopenias, basically. And I'm going to go through each one. And then basically we have a big thrombocytopenia called disseminated intravascular coagulation. But I'm not going to test you on that one, so I don't have it listed here, but we'll talk about it. Immune thrombocytopenic purpura is basically where our immune system attacks platelets. Poor little platelets, they're just out there doing their job, but our immune system tries to eat them up. Or they will also call it idiopathic, meaning we don't know. So that's an actual fancy term for your vocabulary. If anything is called idiopathic, it's a big fancy medical word for we have no clue. So you could just say, basically, I was very idiopathic on my test. I had no clue. Idiopathic means we don't know what the cause of it is. And so they will call sometimes idiopathic or immune sort of the same thing, because whenever we don't know what's causing it, we're like, oh, it must be the immune system. But a lot of times they'll kind of use those words interchangeably. So the I stands for either immune or idiopathic, thrombocytopenia, purpura. And then we have thrombocytic thrombocytopenia, and you're like, oh, this sounds confusing. Well, let's go into it and look at it. The immune is usually what they'll call it idiopathic or immune. It's the destruction of circulating platelets for whatever reason. Usually it's the autoimmune system at fault. And the only symptom is a decreased platelet count and some bruising. So you come in and you're like, I feel fine, but look at all these bruises all over the place. They can draw your CBC, and they notice your platelets is, your platelet count is 15. Well, that's way low, but you have no other problems. It's just a random destruction of platelets. All your other coagulation factors are normal, and, the platelets are being destroyed. Platelets don't live very long. Our red blood cells live 3 months. Platelets only last about a week, and that's because they get easily activated. Platelets, once they're activated, are a one-and-done use. Once they're activated, they're done. They don't unactivate. They don't return to their platelet form. They are platelets just circulating around, waiting to do some jobs. Once they're activated and used in a clot, they are taken out and recycled. But even a platelet, if it never gets activated, generally only has a lifespan of 7 days. So you may see patients who are on anticoagulants and they will take them off for a week before surgery. Maybe they're on antiplatelet. They're taking aspirin, and they are in for a scheduled surgery, and they tell you, all right, you need to go off your aspirin for 7 days prior to surgery. And that is because you will make new platelets within the week. Those platelets that you have given antiplatelet to, they will never be activated, no matter what happens to them, because they have the effects of the antiplatelet on them. So you have to let those platelets kind of get out of the system and get new platelets that haven't been exposed to aspirin, and then they will clot. So does that make sense? That's why they hold that the antiplatelets for, or they ask about, have you taken, you know, any medications for clotting prior to surgery? You've got to get that out of the system. And platelets, if it's an antiplatelet, so the meds that we listed as antiplatelets are any, aspirin, Plavix. They are specific meds that work on platelets. That's why you have to be off of those for 7 days. So just, you know, the more you know, the more things make sense. So, but platelets, once they are exposed to an antiplatelet, will never activate. And platelets, once they are activated, never return to their platelet form. They're basically used up. So one of the things to think about with these platelets is when we're looking at a platelet count. So when we're looking at this platelet count here, guess what this platelet count doesn't tell you is whether they're activated or unactivated. It doesn't tell you whether your platelets are actually useful or not. It just tells you that they exist. But platelets that have been exposed, so you can have a platelet count of 400, but if they were exposed to a high dose of aspirin, not all those platelets are going to go active. So just because you have a good platelet count doesn't mean they're functional platelets. Does that make sense? If you're taking an antiplatelet, you may have made some of those, you've rendered them useless. So even though you have a normal platelet count, they might not work if you've been taking an antiplatelet. But with autoimmune destruction, they don't, they're being destroyed as soon as they're being made. And you don't have platelets. You don't have that first line of defense. So you have a lot of petechiae, you have a lot of purpura, you've got easy bruising, but you do not have any other symptoms. When they do your platelet count, it is low. They've never taken an antiplatelet. There's nothing else going on. They're going to assume it's the immune system. And the treatment for any immune problem or any problem we really don't know what the cause is, they'll treat it as an immune problem and treat it with the two treatments for immune problems are steroids. And because steroids have so many side effects that we talked about on our cortisol level, we don't want to give steroids just to suppress the immune response. This patient could end up in Cushing's syndrome, or they could end up with all the side effects of taking too high of steroids. So what they will do is shut down the immune system with either chemotherapy or anti-rejection meds to allow your platelets to live a little longer. So this is the most common med that they're put on is this rituximab. And it is a chemotherapy med, which basically doesn't let the immune system recognize the platelets, kind of keeps them concealed from the immune system, and lets them live for their full 7 days. Surgical treatment, splenectomy. Again, remember how I said that it stores red blood cells and things in there. It also stores these cells that are holding antiplatelet antibodies. So all those little white blood cells that are hunting platelets. So if we take away the spleen, we reduce some of the antibody cells that are going to try to destroy the platelets. And so basically the removal increases the number of platelets in circulation so that the destruction isn't as rampant. So they will try a couple of things, but they really don't know what causes it, and they will just basically treat it with immune suppression. But you can imagine that a patient that is immune suppressed because they want to keep their platelets circulating around is going to be at risk for infection. So any patient with an immune problem that is on an immunosuppressant And they don't, I believe, have a specific med for immune thrombocytopenic purpura at this point. They're just trying general immune suppression. They can also give you a platelet transfusion if your immune system has destroyed too many platelets and you are actively bleeding. But usually they hold transfusions for worst case scenarios. Or yes, if you have ITP and you don't have a lot of working platelets and you're going to undergo a surgery, they might want to give you some working platelets before that surgery. Yes, the immune system will go and attack the platelets that you've put in, but hopefully not until after the surgery. So yeah, and the immunologist, so Lori saying we had a patient with it and he was put on methylprednisone to follow up with an immunologist. Yeah, and the immunologist will figure out a little bit more about, and we'll be doing long-term. And yes, we'll kind of talk about the cancer thing as well, because when we get into the back end there, we'll talk about a little bit of cancers and we'll talk about why they thought he might have had cancer. But what you're going to do is put him on steroids, because again, when we don't know, we're going to put you on steroids. But again, that's only, you should only be on them for like a week or two, and then they need to start doing something long term. So they need to go to the immunologist to do further workup and further labs to figure things out and then figure out what treatment they're going to be. Platelet transfusions, and ITP is actually pretty rare. So someone having just random low platelets is something that they probably are going to refer them to see something, because basically, why do you have such low platelets? Is it an immune problem or is it a bone marrow problem? Is your bone marrow not making platelets? And if your bone marrow is not making platelets, it's probably because something's wrong in the bone marrow. And that's where we talk about leukemias. Can heparin cause this? HIT? Heparin, yes, HIT is a different kind of purpura. It's not an immune thrombocytopenic purpura. It's not ITP. It's its own case. But yes, there is a heparin purpura or a thrombocytopenia. So let's keep going. And what we're going to point out is our intervention. So recognizing it was the low platelet count and petechiae. Our treatment and our education for these patients is going to be anybody with a low platelet count, anyone with a risk of bleeding, so anyone with any kind of coagulation disorder, whether it's platelets or clotting cascade factors or any kind of clotting disorder whatsoever, if they are at risk of not clotting or if they are on anticoagulants or antiplatelets, they should be on bleeding precautions. And so these are general principles, some of them common sense, some of them not, but definitely anything that's going to cause bleeding, we are going to avoid on any patient with low platelet count, high PT, PTTs, INRs, people that are on anticoagulants, people who are on antiplatelets, people who don't have good platelet counts, we will be doing bleeding precautions. Does that make sense? I'll just let you read through bleeding precautions, but anybody that has a deficiency in their clotting, whether it's platelets or anticoagulants, or I mean, whether it's platelets or clotting factors, will be on bleeding precautions. You don't have to physically put a sign on the door. You should be doing this automatically on any patient that's on any anticoagulant or any platelet. These are kind of common sense measures. Anybody's on an anticoagulant platelet, you should be watching their platelet count, coagulation studies, and hemoglobin hematocrit, because that will tell you if you're bleeding. You should avoid IM injections in patients with any anticoagulant antiplatelets. I mean, I'm wondering if the audio is cutting out, then I might be getting, I kind of asked my kids to not be streaming things, but they are streaming things. I'm going to put on my hotspot. Let me pause for a second. I'm going to go on my own internet. I think it's my kids are streaming. It's 11. They're all awake now, so they're probably streaming things. So let me just change my internet. Let's see if this works. Give me a second here. From work actually at night, because as when you were doing charge at night and there you couldn't get support from anybody else, really, you learned a lot of stuff about about computers. So I learned a lot about computers and basically shutting them off and restarting again. I have actually two computers on. One is showing me the chat and one I'm controlling the PowerPoint. So it's I don't have to leave the whole chat to fix one computer. But yesterday my main computer went dead and there's always something going on. All right. So let's see where we were. This was the slide I was left on. We were doing bleeding precautions. And we were talking about, well, dogs can unplug things, man. Dogs are just as bad as kids. They don't use the internet, but, man, dogs can get people in trouble, too. Luckily, I don't have any dogs up here. I only have cats right now, so my kids are causing most of my trouble. But I'm on my own internet, so we shouldn't have any issues anymore. So let me know if I cut out again, because if I'm cutting out, it's probably because something is happening to my internet. So I appreciate that. Cats are not the worst. Cats are lovely. All right. We should do pet show and tell. My cats are downstairs, though. They're not going to be. We should put everybody put on their Wi-Fi and do pet show and tell. Let's take a break and have everybody show their pets. Can you turn up? Well, if you're in listen only, I guess that'll be a pain in the butt. We should just have a pet session one day. We should just have a random pet session where everybody, we'll do a Google Hangouts and everyone can show everybody's pets. Because I think it's a little hard on this one because you'd have to log back in and show it. Can you show your webcams on your view? Should we do a pet view? See if you can show a, I don't know. Yeah, you know what? I wonder if it's going to be too much trouble. I would love to see people's pets, though. I don't know if everybody has Microsoft Teams. Oh, I see Lauren's popping in. She found how to get her video. Let's see your little puppy up there. Oh, hello, Lauren. Look at your little guy. Is he like hematology? Oh. Anybody else have a pet? Let me scoot out of this for a minute. Let's do a pet break. Go get your pets. I'm going to stop screen sharing for a minute. Let's see how many people we can get on the screen. No? Nobody else? You didn't see Lauren? Oh, I saw Lauren. All right, I don't think this is probably the best hangout for it, so sorry. We'll do one, though. I want to see everybody's pets, and I want to see you guys again. You know what was really fun was watching your test footage. I just loved it. Not because it was just good to see all your faces again. And, you know, I just smiled. It made me smile because, one, you know, I can see stress on people's faces, and I just wanted to just reach out and pat heads. I was like, no, I'm sorry. But I did see, you know, people kind of walking back through the background. I saw kids. It was pretty fun. The number of flags were actually reduced, so you guys did a great job on the test. But I really enjoyed watching all that on the test. I missed you guys. I missed your faces. So anyway, we'll have to get together on just like a low-stress, like no-class kind of hangout. Maybe I'll post one of those on like, yeah, either Google Hangouts or Microsoft Teams. Can you get onto Microsoft Teams without having Microsoft, though? Because we use Google as our, you know, internet and our web. So I think Google Hangouts will work better with our Maricopa stuff. So anyway, we'll figure something out. We'll do a fun just gathering. And you guys can totally gather on your own as well. But you know, I'm sure you guys are probably figuring out ways to do study groups online. And, but really my kids are thinking this is nothing new with them. They're all internet, they're all on Discord servers and they're talking to their friends and they're talking to their friends more than they're not in school right now. So they're constantly, yeah, like I'll have to look into Discord. Apparently Discord does a lot of stuff too. There's so many things out there and, having tech-savvy kids doesn't help because, yeah, we'll find something that everyone will have access to that's free that we can we can get online and share pets and just talk and chat. But in the meantime, let's go to class. I just needed a little mental break for a minute. We'll go back to our bleeding precautions. I'll let you read over bleeding precautions. But again, we should be doing bleeding precautions for anybody that is on anticoagulants, antiplatelets, or has a low platelet count. So we'll go with that. And there's just two pictures of bleeding precautions. Then we're going to talk about thrombocytopenic purpura. Thrombocytic thrombocytopenic purpura. So thrombocytopenia means low platelets. So we have low platelets. But what we have, there's also a thrombosis in this name, meaning clots. So this is a disorder of clotting and bleeding. And you're thinking, well, you can't have both at once, but you can. The reason you have a low platelet count is because all of your platelets get activated at once, caused by triggers. So all of your platelets get activated at once, all 400 of them, let's just call it 400, all of them get activated. So you are left without platelets because you have to grow new ones. So since all of them got activated, guess what they create when they get activated? Active platelets cause a clot. So we have a disorder of clotting and then bleeding because all of our platelets got used up. So it's not destruction of platelets, and it's inappropriate activation of platelets. So because we have an effective level of platelets that all of a sudden all got activated, we have clots all over our body. Wherever these platelets are, they stop and stick. So we have clotting all over the body. And of course, clots are much more apparent in smaller little vessels. So you will have microclots all over the body. And then we've used up our platelets. And so now any new bleeds will continue to bleed. So these triggers in this disease cause microclots and bleeds. And this also causes a hemolytic anemia too. Off on the side, this defective enzyme, this is a bad coding problem. There, we don't know if we have this defective enzyme unless you have an episode of TTP. Is this similar to DIC? Yes, this is probably the most similar to DIC. Disseminated intravascular coagulation is also an episode of bleeding and clotting. So this is the most similar to DIC. It's a different enzyme, a different activation. It's free for students by a friend. Okay, Katie, I'll look into, or Catherine, I'll look into the Microsoft Teams thing for a fun hangout. But going back to TTP, it is different than DIC in that it's a different enzyme and a different cause, but the effects are very similar, okay? And actually, the triggers are very similar. But this, it's a different enzyme, so you can't call them exactly the same thing. But if you study TTP, you have probably studied DIC as well. Or disseminated intravascular coagulation. But yes, this is basically your entire platelet count has been activated, and now it's clotting all over the place, and you are also bleeding because you haven't grown new platelets yet. The difference with DIC, though, is that there's no hemolytic anemia involved in DIC. Okay? So when I'm saying this is similar to it, it's not exactly the same. The clotting and the bleeding is the same, but this TTP comes with also hemolytic anemia because the defective enzyme that is triggered here is on platelets and on red blood cells. So when this defective enzyme is triggered, it causes all your platelets to just poof, turn into little sticky puffer fish, and it causes your red blood cells to lyse. So this TTP is almost in a way a little bit worse than DIC because you also have a hemolytic anemia on top of it. So whereas DIC, disseminated intravascular coagulation, is microclots and bleeds. Okay. So I should probably put a slide in here for DIC, but I didn't want to make a ton of people figure that they need to study DIC when all I need you to know about DIC is that we've got the microclots and bleeds. TTP is DIC plus, and it is pretty rare to have this defective enzyme. But what this TTP does is not only cause microclots and bleeds, but cause hemolytic anemia. The triggers for it are very similar to the triggers for DIC. Pregnancy, cancer, HIV, lupus. It's basically things that trigger. Do we know which enzyme is at fault? Laurie, I'm going to let you look that up. I do not. That sounds like a very scientific question. I never looked up the actual enzyme, and it wouldn't be important to know. But if you would like to know it, by all means, look it up. And have that in your knowledge store. It won't be bad for you, but I won't test you on the enzyme. And basically, for DIC, the enzyme, no, DIC, they think DIC is part of a massive autoimmune response, and the massive autoimmune response causes your platelets to go active. So they're different causative factors. Well, thank you, Lori. Adam TS13. Don't write that down because I won't test you on it, but if you ever wanted to know. You can see TTP is a lot rarer than DIC. DIC usually happens because we have a big immune response that sets off just platelet activation. Whereas here that these triggers trigger this defective enzyme. Again, don't get hung up on the differences, but if you do have this rare disorder of TTP, you will have bleeding, clotting, and hemolytic anemia. Don't memorize the causes. Is the enzyme for what? Sorry, I missed something. No, the enzyme just exists in your platelets and in your RBCs. It's one of the enzymes that's a building block, or I don't know if it's one of the enzymes that's there for auto destruction. All of our blood cells are triggered with an auto death time. They have a fixed time span. And this enzyme is probably involved. I'm trying to think of I can't think of the name for it. Apoptosis. I'll tell you, APOPTITS. It means programmed cell death. You're making me go back to man, my biochemistry major, way back into my brain to find that. But apoptosis is programmed cell death. This enzyme is probably existing as part of the programmed cell death, that when the cell is programmed to die, the right blood, red cells and platelets, this enzyme is helping break it down during its auto. So basically these platelets are programmed to live 7 days and then they disappear. Red blood cells are programmed to live 3 months and then they disappear. They have a lifespan, and at the end of their lifespan, basically the cell self-destructs. And that's a normal response in our body. And probably this enzyme is involved in that process. Pretty rare. But like I said, so if this enzyme gets triggered, it's going to create platelet destruction and red blood cell destruction. So these triggers are what trigger it, and you won't know that you have it unless you get something like this and the enzyme is triggered and you end up with an episode of TTP. So we don't like this. Clotting, bleeding, hemolytic anemia sounds terrible. What do you think we're going to do for it? What do we know about hemolytic anemia that you know you're going to do for it? And probably something that would help move along sticky platelets. Fluids. There's no real need for oxygen at this point unless they have low oxygen level. And here's all your cues going on. And again, because we've got microbleeding, microclotting, we've got the hemolytic anemia. Hemolytic anemias can cause kidney failure, liver failure because they have microvessels in them. And so when you have these little microbleeding, microclotting, it affects all of your internal organs as well. And the hemolytic anemia, these blown up cells can cause, they can cause blockages in the kidney. It can cause liver failure because the liver's trying to process all these cells that are dying. But hydration, fluids, remove the trigger if you can find it, if you realize that the person's going through this. And again, it, because DIC looks about the same, well, the spleen's going to sequester the actual, I mean, a splenectomy is probably, this is going to be a, almost along the line of a crisis level thing. What you're going to do is this, you're probably only going to see this during a trigger episode. A patient who is not being triggered isn't going to have this on a daily basis. I don't think the spleen helps out on this one. Which aspect is more critical, the clotting or the bleeding? I think it would depend on where the clotting is happening, because if the clotting is happening in your brain, lungs, or heart, that would become more critical. Or if the bleeding is happening in your brain, lungs, or heart. So I can't give you a full-on answer on which aspect is more critical. It really would depend on what's going on. If you're in the middle of a TTP episode and you rupture a vessel in your brain, then the bleeding becomes more important. I think the microclots, if you're having them up in your brain or your chest or your heart, if they're happening there, remember they're small. So, and no, the clotting is happening all over your body. So just wherever the platelets were circulating, remember platelets are just roaming around in your bloodstream. They could be activated anywhere. And so there's not going to be a central area where clotting is happening. It's going to be happening all over your body. And they're going to be mostly capillaries. They're not going to cut down blood flow to like your entire brain or your entire heart or your entire lungs or your entire kidney. It's going to be happening in small little bits everywhere. So I'm going to say probably the damage we're more worried about is going to be the bleeding. If I had to choose between the two on an NCLEX question, which you wouldn't, but since you proposed me an NCLEX question, I will go with bleeding because the clotting is usually microclotting and it doesn't affect an organ as a whole. And so I think we're going to let that go and we're going to be worried more about large-scale bleeding. But anyway, the treatment, of course, is to see, oh my gosh, look at this patient. I mean, they're bleeding, they're bleeding. They might have little finger ischemia. They might have, they have these microclots in these tiny capillaries. Yes, and what do you think, is that going to be painful? All this microclotting? Oh, heck yeah. This is ischemia. This is going to be pretty painful. So when I'm looking at this patient as a human being that I need to treat, I'm worried about all these things, but what are our priorities? My priorities are going to be, what's going to treat the pain? We're kind of, even though this isn't sickle cell, we're going to go to those thought processes. What's going to ease the pain? The pain is being caused by these clotting episodes causing ischemia. Look at those fingers there. So if they are having pain, we know that hydration is going to treat the clumping, the clotting. We can get these activated platelets kind of diluted so they can't stick in one place. We can keep them circulating, and maybe one random platelet sticking here and one random platelet sticking there is not going to cause these ischemic clot big things. So hydration is going to be my priority in this patient. Pain control, of course, if they're having pain, hopefully that we will get hydration in on this pain. The other thing is that this patient doesn't have a history of sickle cell. This is not a five-year-old that has a genetic disorder. This is someone coming in and you're like, well, this is not, and sickle cell doesn't cause big bruising. So you're going in and maybe they're coming in with the diagnosis of TTP. You know that you need to hydrate them. Yes, it's appropriate to give them pain meds. But what can stop this? And a lot of this is trying to get to the bottom of what was the trigger of this. If surgery was the trigger for it, well, you can't stop the surgery.
it's over. It's done. They're in it now. If they have HIV, you can only keep it under control. If they have cancer, you can't stop that. Some of these things we can't stop. And if it's a med, of course, we could stop the med. If it's something that's infected, we could treat the infection. But there's a lot of things that we can't stop the trigger. Just like with DIC, if it's caused by an autoimmune response in the body, a large immune response, we can try to stop it the best we can. But we need to maintain the patient while they're getting over this. Would this be the first sign of a cancer diagnosis? It could be on someone with the defective enzyme. It could be. But the thing is we're not going to waste all of our time just trying to get to the trigger, because that is the what would fix the problem, is to remove the underlying disorder. But sometimes we can't. So that's an idea. But aggressive hydration will stop the clots from being, oh, I'm gone? I shouldn't be gone. No. I will come back. Am I gone forever? I'm back. I'm gone. I'm back. We're working on it, man. Let me get my screen back up. Thank you for giving me updates on my status. I can hear myself. So let me get... Go back. Come on. I can see my little microphone moving, so let's see if the screen comes up again. You guys are my allies here in this fight. Okay. We're back to the screen. I see it up, so hopefully we're good now. All right, voice good? Give me a thumbs up or a yay if you can hear me. Okay, good. Hopefully it was just a blip. So what we're going to do is we're going to hydrate. We're trying to prevent the clots from causing ischemia and pain. So hydrate, 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 hydrate. We are putting them on 100% bleeding precautions. We know bleeding is going to be a problem. This is not like spontaneous rupture of bleeding, not just bleeding is going to happen because you've destroyed bleeding. This is going to be that if something happens to you, you will continue to bleed. So all those little micro things that happen will cause bleeding. But you certainly don't want this patient to fall, to bump their head, to be playing with razors. Bleeding precautions are big here, okay? We know that if this patient is having these micro clots, they have activated their platelets. We're going to hydrate them to keep those platelets moving around and stop them from sticking together. But bleeding is a big, big problem here. It's not a given that you're going to just spontaneously, randomly bleed. But the problem becomes in any kind of damage to any vessels or any bruise, you know, like you knock your knee, it's not going to just hurt. It's going to bleed now. You've lost your platelets. But remember, our clotting cascade still works. So our first line defense is broken, but our second line defense is still there. So we will bleed, but hopefully our clotting cascade is all right. Now you get TTP with liver damage. Uh-oh, we've got a problem. So hydration is our mainstay. And then we want to get rid of, and then because this one's got the hemolytic anemia component to it, we want to get all this damage out of the system. So plasmapheresis is a form of dialysis for the plasma. This is not to remove waste products from the body, like dialysis is, but we do plasmapheresis with the dialysis machine, but that does not mean their kidney is broken. It means that what we're doing is we're exchanging their blood plasma. So what the dialysis machine will do is it's not set up with dialysate and you don't have a fistula and you're not doing anything kidney-wise, but you use the same machine to pull blood out of the body and it actually spins down the plasma and you replace it with plasma from the blood bank and you return your own blood, you know, your blood cells and white blood cells and all that, you return that back to the body. So the formed elements get spun back to the body
and you replace with plasma. It's pretty fascinating to actually watch. Plasmapheresis is usually only done in the ICU. When we go down to pick up the products for a plasmapheresis, they give you an entire file box of plasma because you're replacing about 4 liters of plasma. So you get tons of plasma from the blood bank, fresh frozen plasma, get probably, it's like 20 bags of plasma, and you hand the bags off to the dialysis nurse and say, thank goodness I'm not a dialysis nurse and have to check all this nonsense. But sometimes you check it with the dialysis nurse. But they're not doing dialysis. They're doing something called plasmapheresis, which basically will clean out your blood and replace it with fresh plasma. Plasma has our clotting factors in it, some platelets that are not activated. We will put these things back in the body. So you get plasma and you get platelets, and we will basically take out your deformed ones and put in fresh ones. So you can imagine, what kind of access do you think you need to have to do plasmapheresis? You're going to do it through an 18 gauge? Wait 2 months for a fistula? It's going to be a central line. I'm not sure if they can do it through an 18 gauge or not. It would be a dialysis catheter, and I'm pretty sure it has to be, I don't think they have them less than a dialysis catheter, less than a central line. So they'll get a temporary central line access for this plasmapheresis. If anyone's seen plasmapheresis done another way, let me know. I've never seen it done another way because I always worked in the ICU. It's always done through a central line dialysis catheter, done on a machine that looks like a dialysis machine, but does not have dialysate, and we're not balancing electrolytes, and we're not removing fluids. We're basically taking blood out, putting blood back in, but we're letting them keep their working blood cells. We're letting them keep their working white blood cells. We're letting them keep their formed elements and just replacing plasma and platelets. And again, you don't need to know how to do this. I probably 100% don't know how to do it. I know how to go to the blood bank and pick up the plasma and platelets and deliver it to the pheresis nurse, but I don't do plasmapheresis other than watching them for, for improvement or worsening. So with TTP, what I'm going to test you on and what I would expect you to know on TTP is that they would get hydration and plasmapheresis. That's pretty much it. I mean, all the rest of this stuff I'm telling you is just for knowledge. But we are going to watch for, if you had activated platelets, clotting, bleeding, and hemolytic anemia that we know can cause kidney and liver problems, we're going to be watching all of that stuff to see if it improves. So after a pheresis episode, we are going to draw blood, check their clotting, check their PT, check their PTT, check their platelet levels, making sure that everything has been replaced appropriately. We are going to make sure that they stay safe, that they don't have episodes of bleeding. Bleeding precautions is big, and we are monitoring very closely for any episodes of bleeding until after we can get our pheresis done. And hopefully after we get pheresis done and we've removed those activated platelets and put in fresh, clean ones, everything should be back to normal. And then we just have to maintain hydration to keep that clots from forming and let the body heal itself. Okay? Does that make sense? A TTP episode is something that we are concerned about, but does have a treatment, and plasmapheresis is the treatment, but we will continue hydration before that and after it to maintain, get those clots circulating, make sure all that stuff gets cleaned up and does not cause too much stress on our filtering organs. So that is TTP. And then we have a hit. So someone asked a while ago about heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, and this is kind of similar to the immune thrombocytopenia because this is a heparin allergy. So this one causes the widespread activation of platelets or a drop in platelets. So there's two types. The first one develops within, and you see, look, both of these hits,
don't happen right after you give heparin. This is not like an anaphylactic. This is almost like a contact dermatitis. It takes a couple of days to develop. And so it's not diagnosed very easily. The type 1 is just basically a drop in heparin count, a drop in platelet count. If you're not drawing labs, you'll never see it. So you could get a dose of heparin, go home and go about your merry way and never know you had hit. Because all type 1 does is drops your platelet count. So there's two types, and I think, let me, so that you don't. Type 2 is heparin causes widespread activation. Type 1 is the drop in platelet count. So let's just change this around, because when I put something at the top, it looks like it applies to both. And it doesn't. Okay. So hopefully that's a little clearer. Sorry about confusing slides. And usually I do this lecture right after the test, and so we're all brain fried, and I've probably never cleaned up these slides very well. So heparin allergy, HIT, you have two types. Sorry. I'm going to fix this formatting. Bear with me for a minute. I'm in a chatty mood today. Tab, tab. All right. So you're getting this great new presentation. All right. So type 1 heparin-induced allergy. Type 1 HIT, drop in a platelet count. Nobody will usually see it unless... And it's self-recoverable. So a lot of people with type 1 never know that they even have this heparin allergy. Just drops their platelet count. Maybe they have a couple more bruising, and then it's all gone. Type 2 is the one we're really worried about. But look, it develops almost a week after heparin. Lord have mercy. If you're on heparin for a couple of days, we might start seeing it while you're on a heparin drip. But most people are only on heparin for 24 or 48 hours. So what's happening is heparin, so you could all be seeing this. Maybe you had a patient that was, you know, on heparin drip for something, and now you're seeing them and getting ready to discharge them, and you're finding something odd going on. But this basically causes widespread activation of platelets. So guess what happens with widespread activation of platelets? So type 1 HIT is very similar to the immune, just drop in platelet level. Type 2 HIT is very similar to the TTP. Or DIC. Does that make sense? Because actually this is more similar to DIC. I'm going to put a DIC slide in here. I can't get around it. Type 2 HIT is very similar to disseminated intravascular coagulation. In fact, it is a form of disseminated intravascular coagulation because it is a widespread immune response that causes activation of platelets. So I guess we could even call heparin-induced thrombocytopenia a kind of disseminated intravascular coagulation, because in DIC, it is just widespread activation of platelets. So these sticky platelets cause microclotting. There's no new platelets to form clots, so you get some bleeding. The platelet count will drop and it does not recover because we don't have time to make new ones. And this one has a high risk of DVT, PE, MI, and stroke. So what do we do for it? Type 1 HIT, we don't do anything for. You're just like, wow, that's there, if you found it. Type 2 HIT, what are we going to do for it? No one? Nothing? Wow. We're going to stop flushes. I should probably put in here, if type 2... So let's put in some things. Is all of these. If you find it, they can reverse heparin with something called protamine. So if you do find it, they will probably do all those things, and type 2, it will be Do they do warfarin or Coumadin? Let me think. I think because warfarin acts separately, that they can do warfarin and Coumadin. Yes, it is an allergy. If they get down to the fact that that is what caused it, if that was the trigger, and if they do, so if your patient is diagnosed with heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, then that should go down on their chart as an allergy. So the only thing we would do differently between the two, type 1, we're not too worried about, we'll monitor it. They may, if they see that you got heparin and you have type 1, they may reverse the protamine. But the thing is, the circulating heparin is probably long gone. It might not do any good. But there is an antidote or a way to reverse heparin, and it's called protamine. But for type 1, you would definitely permanently stop all heparin. Never make sure it gets off Thermar. It's an allergy, so you're going to remove it. Make sure it gets off Thermar, stop all heparin that they're getting, and if they have heparin circulating around, they can get protamine, and it should go on their allergy as a medical record. In type 2, because they're having, if they're having microclotting and activation of platelets, we will go ahead and possibly, they will get the same treatments as TTP. So we could even do, I've done plasmapheresis on these patients if it's bad. They've treated them too with aggressive hydration and circulate, and then basically we'll put plasmapheresis down here. If it's severe, usually the protamine is enough to get the heparin out of the system and reversed, that you don't have to go to plasmapheresis, but I have seen it, so I'll leave it on there as an option. Okay, so there's our probably needed to be cleaned up, what we do for the heparin-induced thrombocytopenias. And like I said, type 1 hits very similar to the immune one. It's just a drop in platelets. If they know it's due to heparin, they will reverse the heparin, but they should get that on their allergy record. Type 2 hit is very similar to the TTP, and so we will give them the aggressive hydration, but because we can get rid of the heparin with protamine, that would happen before plasmapheresis. Does that make sense? The reason we do plasmapheresis with TTP, it's an enzyme issue. There's nothing we can do to fix it, so the only thing we can do is get rid of the plasma and replace it with some clean stuff. With type 2 hit, we can reverse circulating heparin. So we'll try that before we do plasmapheresis. But it's on the table if you're doing really bad. And I put it down here in this. We're gonna just get rid of that. We put it in the right place. Okay, so sorry about that slide. Hopefully watching me fix the slide helped you learn hit a little bit more. But they are also... if it's type 2, they're probably more risk of bleeding, so they should get bleeding precautions. So most of the about HIT, if you know immune, that's type 1. If you know TTP, that's going to be similar to type 2. And just know that heparin does have a reversal agent for protamine, and that is considered an allergy and should go on the allergy list. Okay, do we need a break or should we keep going? Go. Somebody keep going. Okay. This is our last one. So we went through red blood cells. We went through platelets. Now we're going through the white blood cells. Okay. We're going on to the leukocytes. And these are white blood cells. Leukocytes. Our white blood cells are our natural born killers. They are our defense system. These are our immune response. There are all kinds. If you go back to A and P, you probably learned the kinds. I'm not going to test you on all the different kinds. I told you we don't need to know the differential. But just FYI for people that like to know the backgrounds. Neutrophils are the most common. There's all kinds of different ones. Some of them are... they're mostly our first-line defenses, the fills. Are our first line, and the monocytes.
Those are our non-specific. They'll attack anything. And those are usually the ones that are just our first line attackers. The lymphocytes, the B cells and the T cells, are the ones that are specific to certain triggers. So if you've been exposed to a cold, you have memory cells. And those are considered, those are lymphocytes. Those are cells that attack only certain antigens. Neutrophil, basophils, eosinophils, monocytes, they'll attack anything. They'll attack anything that's on there. They help digest old cells that have broken. They just do a lot of cleanup duty. And B cells and T cells are kind of the specific guys. There is a great, I think on my class prep for this hematology, there is a great crash course on all these different cells. And I loved watching it. It was really fun and entertaining. And if you want to know a little bit more, you can go to that. But what I'm going to tell you is that the lymphocytes get trained in a place. So they're made, all the white blood cells are made in the bone marrow. And then if you're going to be a T cell, you get sent off to the thymus gland, and that's why they're called T cells. They get sent off to the thymus gland to learn what they're going to be programmed with. So as the memory cells. So basically they're all made in the bone marrow, but some of them go and get extra duties out in the thymus gland and stuff. And that's why the T cells are named T cells, because they went to the thymus to learn about their specific antigen that they're going to fight. This is kind of a little summary of things. And I love, it says leukemia, so I put it here in the white blood cell count. But look at this bone marrow thing where it says erythrocytes, anemia, weakness, pallor. This is a great summary slide of everything that we just went over. Lymphocytes is infection, fever, if you're missing them. Platelets, you have bleeding and decreased clotting if you're missing them. I just like that little summary slide. But the reason it is here is because when we have white blood cell disorders, they are usually in the bone marrow. So let's go through and look at this. So let's look at these leukemia. So usually our white blood cell disorders come from the bone marrow. And the bone marrow is our factory. There is a stem cell, and it can turn into any of our white blood cells. So basically what's happening is something is happening in the bone marrow. And when it happens in the bone marrow, there's a disorder in the bone marrow. It is called a leukemia. Okay. So when this disorder happens in the blood marrow, they will give you the name leukemia. When it happens outside the blood marrow, you get a lymphoma. But basically what you're having is you have two different kinds of leukemia. You get a lymphocytic or a myeloid leukemia. So this little flow chart here kind of tells you what's happening. And so we have a cancer. If it's a myeloid leukemia, it's happening in the bone marrow, guaranteed. But it is some abnormal cell that is growing out of control. And what happens with all the leukemias is this cancerous cell grows out of control and basically takes over production of the bone marrow. So it grows out of control and it causes anemia and thrombocytopenia because it has crowded out the production. Remember, this is a factory that produces all three things, white blood cells, red blood cells, and platelets. But now we've got a white blood cell precursor that's just going crazy. And you're making a bunch of useless cells instead of making actual functional cells. So the bone marrow has been hijacked by this cancerous myeloid cell. And it is creating itself. And this myeloid cell doesn't actually do anything. It's not turning into any of its red blood cell platelets or white blood cells that it's supposed to turn into. So it stays as a myoblast, it stays as this myeloid stem cell, and never turns into what it was supposed to turn into. So guess what you have on your readings when you go in to look at them. If you have a myeloid leukemia, you will have red blood cells, platelet deformity, and white blood cell deficiency because your bone marrow is not producing them. Does that make sense? So if you have a leukemia, it could be in one bone marrow factory. It could be in all your bone marrow factories. So do they have a deficit of good cells and a bunch of useless cells? Yes. They have a bunch of basically stem cells. These myoblasts are kind of all over the place in the bone marrow, and they're taking up all the room. And the bone marrow is now making myoblasts, and they're getting signals from the rest of the body. Hey, make some red blood cells. Hey, make some platelets. Hey, we're low on white blood cells. And it's like, dude, I am committed. Look at me. I'm full. I've got all these myoblasts. I can't make any more. And so you are full of these myoblasts, these cruddy cells that turn into a deficit of, there are not any actual useful white blood cells. There are no red blood cells and platelets because the myoblasts crowded out the production facility. So you end up with, and then these also can migrate. These cells can metastasize and go and start creating themselves in other organs as well. But, and I don't need you to know which one's acute and which one's chronic. But just know if you have a leukemia, one, we're doing it in the blood marrow, and two, will they have normal lymphoblast counts? Yes, they could, because that is not the cell involved. But if the marrow has been so fully taken over by the myoblast, then they will not have normal counts. Does that make sense? If the leukemia is far enough along, you end up with aplastic anemia, which is not enough red blood cells, not enough platelets, and not enough white blood cells. So in the beginning of these cancers, before the myoblast has maybe taken over a lot of bone marrow factories, so let's say you have a leukemia tumor in your right femur. That myoblast of your right femur bone marrow has been taken over. Well, you still are making them in your left femur, in your humerus, in your other marrow facilities, okay? So when your daughter was diagnosed with CML, her spleen was the size of an 8-month fetus, and she had thrombocytopenia. Her platelet count was 6. So, no, pancytopenia and aplastic anemia are the same thing. Pancytopenia means that you are just low on all your different kinds of red blood cells. So pancytopenia and aplastic anemia are a similar name. So Margaret, you've got some experience here. So yes, she had thrombocytopenia because her marrow couldn't make platelets. Why was her spleen so big? What was it sequestering? What do you think, or what did they tell you? It was sequestering these myoblasts and all of the, well, so it was storing the defective cells, but it's also storing these myoblasts that have gotten out and started migrating around. They're pretty big cells. The dead red blood cells, yes, it's storing all of those things that are circulating around, but the problem is the bone marrow stops making new ones. It just makes myoblasts. So remember, we have multiple marrow factories. We've got a lot of large bones that make these cells are made all over in all of our marrow. So when it first starts, it's pretty insidious. Like somebody was saying, they just came in with a low platelet count. But we don't know if their low platelet count is just because the platelet production has been crowded out. Are they still making red blood cells? Are they still making sufficient white blood cells? There's a lot that goes into this. And I am certainly not a oncologist or an immunologist by any stretch of the imagination. A lot of this I just kind of got from the books in terms of what the counts look like. But as I understand it, these myoblast cells take over the bone marrow, fill up the bone marrow with myoblasts, and then they start migrating out into the blood vessels. They start storing up in the spleen. The spleen's like, I don't really know what you're supposed to be doing, but we're going to hold on to you because, you know, you look important, but let's just stay over here. And so it kind of starts storing them out, but then they can go on and migrate around into the liver as well. But the thing is that as these myoblasts, so them circulating is certainly a problem, but they're useless. They have no function as a myoblast. They haven't turned into what they're supposed to turn into. So they are useless. They are large, useless cells, basically taking up space. But the bone marrow factory is making more and more and more of them. And so they're large, and so they're useless. But now the marrow doesn't have room to make red blood cells and platelets. Basically, the myoblasts cloud everything out, causing the anemia and the thrombocytopenia. Does that make sense? And that's what I got from my reading. If anyone has any more experience other than that, then that is the thing. So somebody was saying, do they have normal lymphoblast counts? Yes, they will have normal lymphocyte counts, but it could be that as the more and more factories get crowded out, then they'll stop producing the lymphocytes as well. Okay, so does that make sense? That basically the leukemias, because it's involved in the factory production is basically hijacked by these useless cells, reducing capacity to produce useful cells. So the leukemias are basically a disorder of your bone marrow, and they are considered white blood cell disorders because it's the white blood cell blasts that are being affected there. And then the side effects of it are anemia and thrombocytopenia. The lymphocytic leukemia is the same idea, but these are the lymphoblasts that are now the trouble. And those lymphoblasts can crowd out the production of red blood cells, white blood cells, further white blood cells and platelets just by causing, bone marrow. They basically hijack the bone marrow. The problem with lymphoblasts and why this one's a little bit worse is whereas the myoblasts kind of are just big and useless and are circulating around and get kind of sequestered in the liver and the spleen, lymphoblasts can get into the central nervous system. And again, I don't know the pathophysiology behind all that, but because these lymphoblasts can get into the central nervous system, this one is associated with level of consciousness changes. So you're like, oh my gosh, this seems like a lot of information. How am I ever going to keep them apart? Well, what I'm going to tell you on the surface, and I mean, I'm certainly not going to train you to be an oncologist or an endocrinologist or an immunologist. What I'm going to tell you to learn about these leukemias is to know that it is a bone marrow disorder. And the reason you end up with an aplastic or a pancytopenia or a disorder in all your blood cells is because of the crowding out of the bone marrow factory by these blast cells. So that kind of covers the two leukemias very, very broadly and the background behind them. And, Margaret, I'm sorry to hear about your daughter. How's she doing? Gonna be quiet while I wait. I put Margaret on the spot with her typing. Sorry about that. And if you have anything else to add, so she's awesome, awesome, almost in remission. Did she do, did they just do it with chemotherapy or did she do bone marrow transplant? We're going to talk about the treatments of all of these in just a minute when we get to those slides, but chemo daily. So at least they can kind of keep it under control. Does she have still kind of low, because she's taking chemo, does she still have low counts? So yeah, low counts for platelets, but her red blood cells and everything are okay. The thing that chemo will do, and I don't know if you guys were supposed to cover chemotherapy in block 2, so I don't really cover it.
and I'm not sure where everybody sits with chemo, but really it depends on the kind of chemo and how it targets the cell. But what it does is it targets rapidly producing cells. Well, that's great. So they obviously found a dose of chemotherapy that's keeping her stable, which is amazing. And it depends on the kind of chemotherapy. Not every single chemotherapy is, you know, hair removing, IV, big guns chemotherapy. There are certainly targeted chemotherapies out there now that only target certain cells, which is amazing. They're doing so much research. It's changing so fast. But the basis of chemotherapy is that it is a drug that targets a rapidly producing cell, or cells that turn over quickly. And so these stem cells are constantly being made, and so we can constantly damage these rapidly producing cells. So I'm not going to go full on into chemotherapy, but we'll go to a couple slides. So thank you for updating us on your daughter. I'm glad she's doing good. And I'm glad they found something that works for her. I hope she stays in remission. But anyway, with these leukemias, I just want you to know bone marrow, and if it's out of control, the blast cells take over the bone marrow, decreasing production of useful red, white, and platelets. Red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets, both the leukemias. Let's talk a little bit about the lymphomas. They're a little different. They are cancers of the lymphocyte, white blood cells only, and they sit in the lymph nodes because our lymph nodes, our lymphatic system, probably way back from A&P and maybe in fundamentals, the lymph system is our drainage system in our body and the place that's kind of like the sewer of our body. It kind of keeps all of our drainage and everything in there, and that's where a lot of the white blood cells work. And they basically, the lymph system kind of drains everything and sends it back towards the GI system in the liver to get further cleaned up. But our white blood cells, most of them function, our memory cells, those lymphocytes, the ones that are going to mature and be targeted and go live in the lymph system, they go and live there. So we have our frontliners kind of running around in the bloodstream to eat up things in the bloodstream. And then we've got the other ones are living in the lymph system to kind of clean up things as, you know, as infection. When we clean up infections, all that junk gets thrown into this lymph system, into the sewer. We don't talk about the lymph system very often. But as we clean up and deal with big, you know, like breaking down scars, breaking down old surgery sites, breaking down infections, all that stuff just basically is thrown in the lymph system where the white blood cells can do their work. So these are lymphocytes go off and work in the lymph system. That's why they're called lymphocytes. So when we look at these lymphoblasts, the B cells, T cells, and the natural killer cells, they go off to go work in the lymph system. The eosinophils, neutrophils, basophils, they're all circulating around kind of in the bloodstream to be a first-line defense. And then the other ones go and hang out in the lymph system to do cleanup duty, and then they can be called into the blood system if they are needed to go to a specific site. But they kind of hang out in the lymph system, and that's why they're called lymphocytes, and they're any cancer of this area is called a lymphoma. It's not in the bone marrow. It's in your lymph nodes. It's in your lymph system. So this is a cancer not in your bone marrow. So guess what? This cancer does not cause aplastic or good news for if you have a lymphoma versus a leukemia is not going to cause the aplastic or pancytopenic problems of having all your counts low. You're not going to have problems with your red blood cells and your platelets. You just have a problem where, you know, these cells went off into the lymph system to work. And then they got stupid, and they got big. And they have a Hodgkin's and a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So these lymph cells, they grew into whatever they were supposed to be, went to the lymph system, and then they kind of mutated out in the lymph system. Well, yeah, you know, I mean, they did. They got stupid. They mutated. And so they turn into something in the lymph system. It has nothing to do with the bone marrow at all. So there is a Hodgkin's and a non-Hodgkin's. The Hodgkin's lymphoma is basically associated with an infection, usually the Epstein-Barr virus. And this virus can basically turn B lymphocytes, I guess if we like it, they could turn them stupid. And this virus basically triggers these B cells to start rapidly producing. And these are called Reed-Steinberg cells. The cell with the Epstein-Barr virus in them are called Reed-Steinberg cells. And this is basically a B cell that was fully formed when it left the bone marrow, got into the lymphocyte, and, you know, started hanging out with the wrong crowd. The Epstein-Barr virus got into it, and now it's starting to growing and rapidly providing. These Reed-Steinberg cells are malignant. They do go all over the place, and they can infiltrate the organs. So Hodgkin's lymphoma, this one is a little bit more worrisome because the Reed-Steinberg cells can get out there. But it is very easily treated with an antiviral because the virus is the root of the problem. So they will treat this Epstein-Barr virus and it will reduce the number of Reed-Steinberg cells. And if you can get to it before it starts infiltrating other organs, then you're doing pretty good. But because these cells are influenced by a virus, they're treated with an antiviral. Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is basically these old lymphocytes. They were supposed to have their programmed cell death, apoptosis, but I guess they got like a complex and they decided they were going to stick around. They are ignoring their programmed cell death, or maybe their programmed cell death went by and they're like, oh wait, nobody came to eat me up. I'm living forever, buddy. So these cells, these lymphocytes don't die like they should. They continue to grow and divide. And so you have all of these lymphocytes in your lymph nodes causing very, very swollen lymph nodes. They don't have the input of the virus. This is just basically the immune system is too busy doing other things, or it's kind of broken anyway. Maybe it's suppressed by something. And so it's not going in there and taking care of these cells when they're supposed to die. And they kind of get out of control because they think they're immune to death, and they keep growing. And so they basically just swell your lymph nodes. And the cues for both of these are painless swollen lymph nodes. They can get painful if they get too big and are, even a lymph node has its limits. But they're usually painless, just swollen lymph nodes. Just like when you get an infection, your lymph nodes get swollen, and that's appropriate because, you know, but they will have large, large lymph nodes. Would it affect all lymphocyte nodes or one or a few? It would depend on where they are living. If you have non-Hodgkin's, it usually works. We have the most accumulation of lymph nodes in our neck, armpits, and groins. So yes, it usually does affect all of those. And so if you have non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, basically you've got a whole bunch of cells and they're like, nobody killed us, we're going to keep going. It's kind of a whole body problem. And Hodgkin's lymphoma, that virus is kind of all over our body. If you have the Epstein-Barr virus, it's all over the body. So that could be anywhere. And plus they're malignant, they move around. So it might start out in one node and then move into, so it will probably start with one swollen lymph node. And then if it goes on, it will be multiple swollen lymph nodes. But usually by the time you see it, it's multiple. Like no one's really going to notice one swollen lymph node. A lot of times you have a sore throat, you get a swollen lymph node. You don't even notice it unless the doc's looking for it. So you don't notice it until it becomes noticeable. And by then it's usually multiple lymph nodes involved. You got big lymphs under your armpits. Does having Epstein-Barr always progress to Hodgkin's? No, not always. It does not always produce. And I don't know the reasons for some people it does, progress to Hodgkin's and some people it doesn't. Probably genetics. I don't know. It's idiopathic. I don't know. Probably somebody does know, but your nursing instructor does not know. But those are the differences between the two, is that Hodgkin's associated with a virus, treat it with an antiviral. Non-Hodgkin's, usually you have something wrong with your immune system anyway, and it's not as easily treated. Neither one of them is as worrisome as a leukemia because it's only the lymph nodes that are being affected. We're not affecting our platelets, our red blood cells, or our white blood cell production It's just that these old cells or these, you know, kind of hijacked cells are taking over and affecting our lymph system. Now, if our lymph system doesn't work, we get a lot of swelling. There's not a lot of drainage. Our lymph circulation doesn't work very well. You get lymphedemas. You get pain and swelling, and that is from the lymphedema. If our lymph system can't circulate and waste can't move through there, you get swelling. So I'm sure you've heard of patients that have lymphedema. They got swelling of their legs, they got swelling of their abdomen, and that's just because the lymph system is blocked up with junk, and the junk being these Hodgkin's or non-Hodgkin's cells. But really, not a whole heck of a lot of other symptoms, and the big cue is the swollen lymph nodes, which patients will notice if it starts getting really, really big. The treatment for leukemias and lymphomas is chemotherapy or some kind of combination drug care. We don't try just one chemotherapy drug usually unless it's targeted for that particular cell. They will get a dose of chemotherapy. Luckily with the lymphomas, hopefully if it's a non-Hodgkin's, you can take an antiviral and a little chemotherapy. The chemotherapy will reduce the rapidly producing cells, and so it will stop that rapid production of those stupid lymphocyte cells. It'll stop the rapid production of those myoblasts, and it kind of slows everything down and allows the system to kind of reset. So basically it interrupts, you know, rapidly producing cells, which are what those blasts and lymphocytes that are rapidly reproducing. So chemotherapy is the treatment for it, and how often and how big of a dose and what kind of meds that you would take are definitely going to be an oncologist. You know, I'm not even going to come close to even putting chemotherapy drugs up there because you were supposed to be kind of exposed to chemotherapy drugs and the most common ones in block two. If you need it, let me know. I'll try and throw something together. But anyway, what I would rather you know about interventions for leukemia and lymphoma rather than memorizing kinds of drugs and things like that is to know that if you're getting a chemotherapy that's aimed at your bone marrow or fixing a bone marrow concern, you are probably getting a much stronger dose, or the stronger your dose, the more you're going to need all these precautions. Chemotherapy, because it attacks rapidly growing cells, it's going to attack, and I think I put, there's some slides here. These really are not testable for you guys, so you can kind of just stop taking notes if you are. I put this here because I'm not sure, because what I was getting the past few semesters was that they didn't have this anywhere before in this in the thing, and then we have a lot of bridge students that didn't have it before. This isn't in our curriculum for Block 3, but I still think it's important for you to know that if you have a chemotherapy patient and they have low white blood cells, they're going to go on neutropenic precautions. And usually the blood cell that we're looking for is the neutrophil. That's one of our first line defenders. So if that's low, it's probably a lot of the other cells are low as well. Neutropenic precautions is what we would call low white blood cells, but it's also low neutrophils. Anyway, they have a higher infection risk. You don't have a lot of white blood cells. You certainly don't have a lot of your first line defenders. You're at very high risk for infection. So those are all the neutropenic precautions. And then you have thrombocytopenic precautions if you have a bone marrow disease. So we probably wouldn't put a lymphoma patient on thrombocytopenic precautions unless they had a low platelet count. But a lymphoma patient is not going to have a low platelet count. They're not going to have a low neutrophil count. They're not going to have a low red blood cell count because the bone marrow is working just fine. They're just going to have an overproduction of these white blood cells. But the chemotherapy might then, the chemotherapy to fix the illness is now having side effects by they're also reducing the rapid production of cells in the bone marrow. So when you go on chemotherapy, you might have not initially had a problem with your white blood cells, platelets, or red blood cells, but now you do because chemotherapy targets rapidly producing cells. And I think in these expected side effects, again, none of this is testable, but I would like you to know it as a nurse. I think it's very important. When you go on chemotherapy, you're at much more risk because chemotherapy, what are our rapidly dividing cells in our body? our red blood cells turn over, our white blood cell. Red blood cells turn over slower every 3 months, so they're not as rapidly dividing as platelets that turn over every 7 days, white blood cells, which are being made constantly. Guess what? Our hair grows constantly. Guess what turns over every 24, 48 hours is our oral mucosa. Turns over very rapidly. We have a lot of cells in our body that just rapidly turn over in general. And chemotherapy is going to mess with those, which was what our expected side effects come from. But because our bone marrow factory is part of rapidly growing cells, chemotherapy does affect them. Some targeted chemotherapies won't have these effects. But if you're giving a general high dose, big IV dose that's going to just wham, bam, thank you, ma'am, kill off anything that's rapidly producing, then we're going to end up with a lot of side effects. I do have chemotherapy precautions on here because, again, people were telling me they'd never heard of them, so I did put them here. So basically, I can say you didn't leave nursing school without seeing this anywhere, but because it's not in our curriculum, I don't need to test you on it, but I would like you to know some chemotherapy precautions. Just in general, for nursing. Here's the body fluid precautions that you would do for patients that are on chemotherapy, you know, in terms of what to do with body waste and things like that. And then the expected side effects, I kind of just go through here. I would just like you to read this at some point during your nursing career, that basically this is why we expect it. It's targeting rapidly growing cells. And so the body's trying to do a lot of cleanup work here. The chemotherapy's going in there and just blowing everything apart and messing up stuff. There's a lot of damaged cells, dead cells, tissues to clean up. You're tired. The GI system has a 2 to 3 day lifespan. So it's considered a rapidly turnover cell that chemotherapy does hit. We don't mean it. It's collateral damage. But this is why they have all these problems, is because we've ruined our GI tract with chemotherapy. Blood disorders, because these are rapidly reproducing cells. Nerve damage and pain. This is not because the nerve cell is actually rapidly reproducing, but chemotherapy does damage nerves. It is a toxin, so it does damage nerves. It causes hair loss because hair follicles are rapidly changing and rapidly growing, and so it interrupts that rapidly changing cells, so we lose our hair. And then this is just basically not expected symptoms of chemotherapy. So if you've had it before, just ignore it. If you've never had it before, I put it there for you. And that is the end of my lecture. So I am going to go to a Kahoot, if you like.